Everyone, a warm welcome to all of you who join us this morning and we're in here in Molesworth Meeting House. Good to see so many here. But there's room for more, so if you're at home and watching this morning and you might think of coming and joining here again very soon, we'd love to have you as part of our fellowship here in the church. But for those who will listen online later, a warm welcome to you too. We have a number of announcements this morning, if you can simply bear with me as we work through these. And one of them is kind of lengthy, but it needs to be done. Firstly, evening service, 6:30. Please do come back and join us then. We're doing this little series called James in Bite-Sized Bits. So taking little bits, bit by bit through the letter of James in the New Testament. One of the main things we're thinking about tonight is the whole issue of temptation. So that's at 6:30. I've mentioned over the last number of weeks the invitation to those who might want to be part of church membership classes, and one or two people have indicated that they do want to be part of those. So if you've indicated that you want to be part of the church membership classes that I hope to begin this month, then if you could wait for a few minutes just after church here at the front and meet with me, after I've come back from seeing folks at the door, if you can meet with me then, I just want to arrange a suitable time to hold those classes with you. Today you will see we have nomination papers available for our Kirk Session election. I'll come back to that one in a moment because that's the long announcement. Wednesday of this week, we meet for prayer at 8 o'clock, prayer and Bible study in the Old Manse at 8. So this is the week when our main focus is on prayer, and the other alternate weeks then we're on the growth groups. We're on our what was our home groups, but they're now in the church. Just if you weren't at those last week, and if you're planning to come on Wednesday week back to growth groups, there are two of the booklets available still. I'll leave them here in the edge of the pulpit. You can pick one up if you want one. But please do, if you're planning to come to the next one, you didn't get the booklet before, do get those because I may need to order some more. And if there are none there for you, let me know. I get some ordered in time. Next Lord's Day, we have a visitor in the morning service. I'll be here leading the service, but Dr. Keith McCrory, who's minister of Maynooth Community Church. Keith has been with us before. You will know on at least one occasion, and he's coming to be our mission-focused speaker now in the month of March. So that's something to look forward to next Lord's Day. You'll see PW meet then on Monday week. And there are one or two other things there you can read the details of events happening outside of our own congregation's life. The other thing just to say this morning is that we have made our creche room available again. It's the first Sunday it has been opened in a good long while, in fact, since the start of the whole COVID business. But at the minute, we can only really make it available for parents to be there with their own children. We haven't just sufficient people available at present to staff it in the ordinary way. So the creche room's available. You can go there from before the start of the service. If at some stage during the service you feel you want to take your little one out and go over there because there's a TV link and you can watch the service and the toys and so on are there for the kids to play with, please feel free to go at any time. Likewise, the little room at the back of downstairs of the meeting house, I know we've been using that kind of as ordinary seating in recent times when we had to restrict the access of seats in the church, but that room is also available. You can close the door there and it's soundproofed, and if you've got a little one you want to take in there, that's fine as well. Please feel free to do that at any time during the service. Now, you will know that in response to all that's been happening in Ukraine, there have been a number of appeals launched from all sorts of quarters to respond mainly to the refugee crisis that's emerging as people leave Ukraine in large numbers. I know some of you will already have given to those appeals, and some of you indeed may have given to the very significant appeal that was launched by Colin Tinsley, and you've seen all of those lorries that he's sending out to Poland. Our Presbyterian Church has also launched an appeal. The moderator has written to us this week about it. They themselves have donated a significant amount of money as a denomination, but they're asking us congregations we might respond to that as well. I know you've been very generous recently in responding to the needs of Maud before she went out to Congo again, and I understand you've given very generously to that. But if you wish to continue giving to the Ukraine appeal, we'll make that available for the next few weeks. There'll be offering plates, that's the traditional offering plates, by the windows here and also in the porch. So if you're giving to the Ukraine appeal, you put it in the offering plate. If you're giving your ordinary church offering, you put it into the plastic box as usual, just so we don't get the two mixed up in any way. You'll see the details there. One of the significant things that actually our church is able to link in with this time is not just Tier Fund Christian Aid, which they usually link to, but Hungarian Reformed Church Aid. And that's significant because there is in that southwestern part of Ukraine, an area that's probably at the minute not really caught up in the conflict greatly, there is a significant proportion of Hungarian people living there. That's an historical thing. When borders were redrawn after the First World War, part of Hungary ended up in Ukraine and in part of it ended up in Romania. But you have a Hungarian Reformed Church district there in Ukraine, and that's why we're linking in. And the Hungarian Reformed Church is our sister church. In fact, in mainland Europe, is probably one of the largest Presbyterian churches in mainland Europe. So that's how part of our aid would be distributed, and the opportunities there over the next few weeks to do that. Now, back to that announcement about the elders' election. I explained this a number of weeks ago, won't go into all the details again, but our method is slightly different this time because we're trying, using a different method that's permitted under the code of the Presbyterian Church, we're trying to maximize the number of elders we can get appointed because we are really short in some ways in the numbers of our Kirk session in recent times. So what is happening? We're asking on these little leaflets, if you're a voting member of the congregation, you simply fill in on this sheet names you are suggesting or nominating to the Kirk session, and they then will see those, and the Kirk session will make the choice, a selection of those whom they are bringing forward as potential ruling elders, and then we come back to you again on a Sunday, probably in the month of April, and there will be a congregational vote, then a secret ballot on the names that the Kirk session proposed to you. But the initial nominations come from the congregation. There is a little leaflet here with a number of blank spaces. Now, it's not that you have to fill all the spaces. That's not the idea. You simply put down the names of those whom you consider, having prayed about it, having reflected upon the messages and so on that I've been preaching, those whom you consider would be suitable to serve as ruling elders in our congregation going forward. And you must sign that form and print your name as well, because we need to verify, it's how we verify that this has come from a voting member. That needs to be signed and printed name as well. The box will be there up until the 2 weeks from today, the 20th. And you can, from any time from this evening onwards, you'll be able to return your nominations on that little sheet of paper. Those are available as you leave today. If you haven't picked one up coming in, they're available beside the offering boxes or in the porch, and you use that to return your nominations of new ruling elders. Now, at this stage, I need to read from the code of the Presbyterian Church. This is eating into our time, but the code says we need to read it aloud. It's printed for you, but it has to at least once be read. So here we go. Paragraph 30 of the code. This is very exciting. I hope the sermon's better later on, but there we go. It is the duty of ruling elders as members of Kirk Session is to work together with the minister in the oversight and government of the congregation for the upbuilding of God's people in spiritual fruitfulness and holy concord, and for the extension of Christ's kingdom among all people. In exercising this leadership, the Kirk Session shall oversee and work along with other members who have leadership roles in the congregation. That's the sort of stuff I've been preaching on over 4 weeks in the past. Ruling elders by their calling share equally with ministers in responsibility for practical witness, both within the congregation and the wider world. In the discharge of their duties, each elder should be assigned by the Kirk Session pastoral responsibilities and or other leadership roles in the congregation. The Kirk Session, along with the minister, should seek to ensure that all elders are equipped to fulfill their duties. And paragraph 31, to be chosen for the office of the eldership in a congregation, a person must be a voting member of that congregation and a regular attendant on its ordinances. He should be circumspect and exemplary in his conduct, both in the church and in the world, of acknowledged piety, endeavouring to maintain the worship of God in his family and held in esteem by the people. Women shall be eligible for election on the same conditions as men. A ruling elder shall not hold office in more than one congregation at the same time, except as a member of an interim Kirk session. And subparagraph 2, that's the one we've just read, shall not apply to retired ministers who may be members of the congregation. So that's the code red, and it will be printed again for you next week, and you can reflect upon that as well as you come to return your nominations. That's all of the announcements. We're going to worship the Lord. As we do, we turn to these words in Isaiah 40, where we're told this about the nations of the world in relation to God. It says this: surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him, all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. To whom then will you compare God? What image will you compare him to? As for an idol, a craftsman casts it. An old smith overlays it with gold and fashions silver chains for it. But do you not know? Have you not been heard? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? He, the Lord, sits above, enthroned above the circle of the earth, and its people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. As our great sovereign God, in comparison to us, in comparison to the greatest people in the world and to all the nations of the world, he is the great creator God. That's our focus these Sunday mornings, and we're going to sing about that again in one of the Psalms. This is a version of Psalm 33 that's coming before you now on the screen. Let all the righteous to the Lord their joyful voices raise.
Thank you.
Let's come to God's throne in prayer. Let's pray. Our glorious and almighty God, the psalmist's words bring joy to our hearts because they remind us who is the one really in control of this confusing and troubled world we live in. We have many reasons any day of the week looking upon the scene internationally or even locally to be distressed, to be discouraged when we see what's happening in the affairs of men and nations. And we see in all its ugliness too often the reality of human sinfulness. And yet we are reminded, just as we come to worship, you are the God who created all things and therefore rule over all things and therefore will be the judge of all men and nations. And none can stand before you, but rather the scriptures affirm to us that one day at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Mindful of that, may we humble ourselves before you in this place of worship this morning. May we be mindful not merely of the sins that offend us in other people, but rather look into our own hearts and have your Spirit and the Word of God search our hearts and see what sins lie within us, what root of pride is often there that rears up against the things of God, that wants to do things our way and have our will done rather than say in humbly in prayer, Lord, thy kingdom come and thy will be done. Lord, forgive us when we have simply sought to overthrow your rule in our lives by our disobedience to your word. Come and show us, Lord, every little place in our lives where that has been so. Sometimes we remember with shame the very terrible sins we may have committed, or the ones that were brought into the open and that others criticized us for, the ones that made us feel so small and miserable. And then we gloss over the other stuff that every day flows out of our lips, passes through our minds, that is impure and unholy, and that we think you take no account of. But Lord, you see it all. There's nothing in any one of our lives that is hidden from you. But Lord, as you see the awfulness of our sin, so you see sinners in need of a Savior. You see people for whom you sent your Son to die. You see those whose sins can be covered through the shed blood of Jesus on the cross, and you invite them to come afresh and say, Father in heaven, forgive me for my sins. Bring me that cleansing that Jesus purchased for me when he paid the debt I could never pay at Calvary. Lord, mindful of the Savior's great love for us, may we seek your mercy again today. May people even call upon your name for the very first time today, realizing that they need Jesus as their Savior. And come to others, Lord, who maybe carry a burden of guilt that they feel they can't get rid of, and know that Christ indeed has paid for it all, and that there's no sin too deep, no past too dark, but the Savior cannot deal with it and change the soul that lies in sin and transform a life that sin has destroyed, and to know the mercy of God that will bring pardon and bring peace. Gracious God, do your work in our midst today and show us the depths of your love for us in Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. Now we've come on these Sunday mornings back to look at the book of Genesis. It's quite a number of years. I think I said it was 16 years since we last looked at the opening chapters of Genesis. And therefore it's time with a new generation of people in church, new people have joined us and so on, to come back to these chapters again. We got just into verses 1 and 2 last week, but we'll read through right through to verse 27 of Genesis 1 this morning. We'll probably come back to it for another go next week, but we'll read these verses just now. Genesis 1 at verse 1, this is the word of God. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under it, the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening and there was morning, the second day. And God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land also appear. And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit, in which there is their seed, each according to its kind on the earth. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. And the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness, and God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens. So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters and the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. And so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. We end there, verse 27, knowing God will bless the reading of his infallible word. Boys and girls, a wee word for you this morning. Now, you will remember, if you've been with us for a few weeks, what we're doing on Sunday mornings. We're thinking about some of the ways the Bible shows us how powerful Jesus is. And one of the things we've discovered, first of all, is that Jesus is able to control all of nature. So he was in a big storm that nobody could escape from, and out in the middle of the sea. And Jesus, remember, Jesus did what to stop the storm? Remember what he did? He simply said, peace, be still, just stop right now. And that's what happened. We saw then that Jesus also then had power over death, because a little girl was very sick. She wasn't getting better. Her daddy was really distressed and had come help looking for Jesus' help. Frog in my throat. And the little girl died. except that Jesus immediately was able to bring her back to life again. Last day. Remember the crazy guy last week? The guy who was mad, full of the devil and full of demons. Nobody thought anything could possibly be done to help him. He was just completely beyond help, except that Jesus came to where he was, and when Jesus spoke to the devil and told the devil to get away out of him, the demons went out, and the man was completely new person, able to go and tell people in his town what great things Jesus had done for him. So one more thing today. Well, there's two more things, but this is the fourth of five. Another story you will know really well. So here's Jesus, and we'll move on, because he had had a really busy, busy day. Lots of people have busy days, and when you're having a really busy day, you're just tired, and you just wish you could go and have a rest, get your head cleared, and have a sleep. Jesus had been busy teaching. He'd been busy healing sick people, and he said to his disciples, you know, we need to go across the lake here in our boat. And if we go to somewhere nice and quiet, that's a place we could get some rest. But more people wanted to see Jesus, and they said, he's gone in the boat. We'll run on ahead round the side of the lake, and we'll catch up with him. And that's what happened. A huge crowd was there where Jesus and his disciples came. And they kept wanting to hear more from him, and they kept wanting to hear his teaching. They wanted to see him perform miracles and heal sick people. And eventually, as the day went on, well, guess what happened? Everybody was hungry. Everybody was ready for their tea. Except nobody had brought their tea with them. That's the problem. So what happens when you go to school? How do you get your lunch there? Maybe for some of you, somebody makes the lunch, you get a school dinner or something like that. Or maybe somebody, your mum makes a lunch up in a little lunchbox and you take it with you and it's lunchtime, you get to eat it. Well, you know what? That day, there was somebody who had brought their lunch with them. A little boy had a lunch. Anybody know what was in his lunchbox? Yeah. Fish and bread. How many fish? Maybe two. Anyway, how many bits of bread? How many loaves of bread? Yeah. Five. Good man. Five. Good. Five. That's right. Five loaves and two fish. Now, here's the thing. When Jesus saw that the people were hungry and they needed something to eat, and they were nowhere near, there wasn't just a cafe or a restaurant they could all go to or anything like that. Jesus said to the disciples, you've got to feed these people. They said, how are we going to do that? Even if we go into the town nearby, even if we had money, it's going to take a load of money. We simply don't have enough money. It would cost 200 silver coins just to buy bread for all these people. Because the Bible says there was 5,000 men, and it doesn't tell you exactly how many women or how many children there might have been as well. So there was a lot of people. But up came one of Jesus' disciples called Andrew, and he said, well, there is somebody here who's got some food. There's this little boy, and he's brought his lunch. And, of course, other people thought, well, that's not really much use. What could you do with a little boy's lunch, five loaves and two fish to feed all these people? Like, you might share it out with two or three other people or four people, and they could have a piece of bread each or whatever. Each one could have a piece of bread, and some could have some of the fish. But there's 5,000 at least. There's thousands of people. And Jesus said, but that's okay. Just give it to me. What did Jesus do next? What did he do? You remember? Well, yeah, shout out, Charlotte. He prayed, good girl. He spoke to God. He said, he gave thanks to God, his Father in heaven, that God was able to meet the needs of all these people. And after he'd done that, he started breaking the bread and the fish and giving it to the disciples to hand out. And the thing was, they never ran out. They just kept giving out and giving out more bread and more fish and more bread and more fish till everybody had a great big feed, and they weren't hungry anymore. In fact, They'd left bits of the bread and bits of the fish lying around on the ground. They'd dropped bits of it. And Jesus said, go and pick it up. Go to the disciples. He says, go and pick up all the bits that they haven't eaten. Maybe it's like you. So I don't know what you're going to do at lunchtime. You'll go in and you'll have a nice big dinner on the table. And I know what's probably going to happen. You say, I don't really want those pieces of broccoli. I'll leave those at the side of my plate. And I don't only want one potato. I don't want any more than that. And you leave bits. Well, they left bits that day. And they gathered up how much? Do you remember how much they gathered up? You know the story, maybe. They took out some big baskets and they started gathering up the bits. How many baskets did they fill? Remember, anybody? Yeah, Charlotte again. 12, good girl, 12. That's how much was left over. It was an amazing thing. It was another of these things the Bible calls a miracle, because nobody else could possibly have done this except God. And of course, that's what happened, because Jesus is God come to earth. He's God's son. And he talked to God the Father in heaven and said, God, you can do something here to help, but nobody else could do it. And when he spoke to his Father in heaven and prayed, this tiny little amount of food was amazingly multiplied so that it could feed thousands and thousands of people. When Jesus sees people in need, he's able to help their need, no matter how big it is, no matter how difficult it looks to be able to help. Now, here's the thing. One of the things we've been talking about in church this morning is about helping people who are in need. People who've fled away, run away from their homes because they're afraid of fighting and war, and they don't want to be killed, and they've run away to, in fact, to other countries from the country of Ukraine. They've run to Poland, and they've run to Hungary, and they've run to Romania and other places. And the trouble is, they don't have any jobs anymore. They've left their jobs behind them. They've maybe haven't very much money. They've only been able to take a few clothes with them in a suitcase. And how are they going to be fed? And who's going to look after them now that they've run away from the war? And the thing is this, that's why we're asking people to be kind and generous and give to help their need. But we're, as well as giving, we're also praying. We're asking God to help supply their need as well, because it's good that we be like the little boy who says, I can't give very much, but I'll give you what I've got. And that's what the little boy did. He could have said to Jesus, I want to eat my lunch myself. But that little boy said, here's my lunch. It's not very much, Jesus, but I trust in you, and I'm giving my lunch to you in the hope that you can provide and help all these people who are hungry. And that's what you and I can do, boys and girls. If you've got a little bit of money you could give, even a tiny little bit, and say, instead of buying a bar of chocolate with that, I give it to the appeal in church. And maybe that'll help somebody else, another boy or girl, another family, another part of the world, be able to have some food this week, be able to have something that they couldn't get otherwise. So we're going to give like the little boy gave his lunch, but then we also pray that God will do the big things that we can't do. And we're also praying, of course, that God will bring an end to all the fighting and that people be able to get back to their homes and so on again. But that's what God's able to do things we could never do. But sometimes he asks us to come and say, God, what I can do, I'm going to give it to you, whether it's giving your lunch, whether it's saying, Lord, I could help with that. I could help do something for you and to tell people about Jesus and to help out with the work in church or wherever it is. I'll give myself to you, and you're the God who will help other people in need. We're going to pray about that, boys and girls, a moment, and then we're going to sing. Lord, we thank you. You can do miracles, things we couldn't possibly do. You can change things that are so, so difficult. And we would never have the answer as to how we would do it. The disciples didn't know how you could possibly feed 5,000 people. But Jesus knew how, and Jesus had the power to turn a little bit of food into a whole lot of food. We thank you for the power of Jesus. Help us always to trust him. And every time we are up against something really difficult, to remember the first person we talk to is Jesus, because he can do things we could never do. In his name we pray. Amen. I'm going to sing this hymn that says, God can make, will make a way where there seems to be no way. And then boys and girls can go off to children's church. Going to pray again. I know I won't detail our concerns to pray, obviously, for the Ukraine situation again. But for Maud, some of you will have been getting the updates through the prayer texts during the week. Kind of say, just if you want added to the list of those who receive the prayer texts and want to become one part of our prayer team, there is in the announcement bulletin. There's a number there, the prayer ministry number, text number there, and you can text and have something to be added to those who see the updates. Maud has got to Kampala, for those of you who don't know, in Uganda. She is due to go in on Friday coming with the MAF plane to Mulita into Congo, but there's this bag that had disappeared right at the very first stage of her journey over to London. And we thought that wasn't going to be found. It has been found. They found it. But now there's a problem with the airline. First of all, the airline said, well, we'll get it to you as soon as we can. But now the airline has said, because it contained some money and because it hadn't a label on it of a particular kind, they said we can't do that. But the bag's extremely important that Maud should get it. There's a lot of not just money, but other stuff in it that Maud really needs in Congo. Some of us were able to gather early this morning for a time of prayer to pray about that and other things. So we're going to pray about that. I need you to pray for this, because there is a possible route of help. Someone who works for British Airways that Maud knows has tried to say that they will try to intervene and get the bag out to Kampala. But even that's not just straightforward, because BA don't fly there. So we're going to pray about this and lift it before God again this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we've just been reminded in these stories with the children that you're the God who can do things we cannot do. And as we've been singing just now, that you can make a way where there seems to be no way. That's our prayer, Lord, for so many difficult and distressing situations. We're praying for Maud just now. It's been a real trial so far, the delays with the visa in London, now the issue with this bag. And yet we thank you, Lord, you have already provided, as God's people prayed. You've given, opened up the way to get to Uganda. We thank you for the Carpenter family who've been caring for her there and so on. And we pray now that this next little bit of the puzzle that needs to fall into place is a puzzle to us, Lord, but you already know the answer, that you will provide the way for that important bag to be delivered to her. And that then at the end of the week, she's able to get into Melita and continue with a really blessed time of ministry and help and encouragement to people in the few weeks she would have in Congo. Lord, we pray you look after her. You'll keep her safe in your care and provide for her every need at this challenging time. We're making that our continuing prayer for the unfolding situation in the Ukraine. Lord, we can't have a proper command of the politics of the situation or all the stuff that's happening there, but we simply see suffering and distress, and we pray that you will protect people from the vulnerability of simply being bombed out of their homes. We pray that those who are trying to fled as refugees will be kept safe in your care at this time. We pray most of all simply for an end to this whole time of conflict. Lord, we know that would be in the power, not just of Vladimir Putin, but of any leader in the world, just to do the wrong thing and turn a localized thing into a European war. It could happen so simply. We pray that that will not happen, but that the war that exists at present will simply be brought to a peaceful conclusion and people able to return to homes and livelihoods again. Lord, by your divine power, we ask you to intervene and to change hearts and to change minds and to change things that we have no control over whatsoever, but we leave it with you. We also then just privately bring our own cries and prayers to you this today. We every week go into situations in our homes, our workplaces, and in this community where we have stuff that's bothering us, stuff that's a challenge, stuff that annoys us and sometimes causes us anxiety. And we simply pray that we'll be able to lay all those things at the feet of Jesus just now, our great intercessor, our great Savior, and the knowledge that when we pray, Christ hears and answers and loves to answer the prayers of his people. So in silence, Lord, we lay our need before you right now. And Lord, we confidently wait upon you to meet our need and to answer the prayers that we've laid before you for people in need in difficult times. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing again. I was going to read another short passage of scripture, but I'll refer to it later in my message. So we'll sing this piece, which maybe is new to some of you, but some of you, of course, will know it already. What love could remember no wrongs we have done, omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their son. This hymn that has the refrain, his mercy is more. Even our sins are many, Christ's mercy is more.
Our sins they are. patience would wait as we constantly roam. One Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than the darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than the darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than the darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Let's pray together just again as we come to the Word of God. Again, we come to Your Word, and we believe that this Word is no ordinary book. It is the infallible and inerrant truth of God, handed down faithfully through the generations to us. And with that in mind, we pray that we would hear its truth speaking to our hearts this day. In Jesus' name, amen. I can recall as a child being really annoyed one evening when an unexpected cut in the electricity and the power prevented me from watching one of my favourite TV programmes, Star Trek. Remember the Adventures of the Starship Enterprise? That's how old I am. Some of you never heard of that. And Captain Kirk and Mr. Spock and so on. It was the days long, long, long before BBC iPlayer. There was no opportunity to catch up on the thing you'd just missed. Now, I have to say, in adulthood, Star Trek and the like is something I have retained almost no interest in. In fact, so disinterested am I in science fiction, I can honestly say, and wait for it, this is heresy for some of you, I have never watched any of the Star Wars movies. Imagine, same here, sound man, Sam. And I've never seen any of them. Even though they're blockbuster hits across the world, and some of you, probably if you know the script, probably back to front. Anyway, it's not just science fiction, however, that pursues the idea of space travel to other galaxies or the exploring of other civilizations somewhere else in the universe. A significant amount, in fact, of serious astronomy and space research every year is taken up with that question. Is there life out there? Perhaps maybe just the evidence of a little bit of water or some kind of primitive plant life on Mars, or perhaps more fascinating still, the prospect of intelligent life in another solar system, in another galaxy. Now, whilst it holds little interest for me, and I cannot possibly know what is to be found in other parts of our universe, it certainly seems to me, from what I read in Genesis chapter 1, that God in His work of creation had one particular place uppermost in His concern in the whole universe. And it is this world, this earth, this planet we live on. Look again at the opening verses of Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The heavens, thousands, millions of stars and galaxies. The earth, the planet we live on. The earth, a at that stage in the initial part of creation, without form and void and darkness over the face of the deep. And the following verses on from that will describe in brief God's creation of the whole universe, and particularly that lovely line that says, he also created the stars, just like that. That's the story that's handed down to us in God's word. But the focus of this story of creation is this world and everything it contains. Now you might say, but surely that's the case because the Bible is a book written from a human perspective. That's why its big focus is on this world and upon the creation of human beings, male and female. It's looking at human origins because it's a human book. Well, the Bible is not just a human book. The Bible is a book written down through human agency. In the case of Genesis, it was written by Moses. But it is a book that was given to all of its various authors, the 66 different books in the Bible, given by divine inspiration. Remember what Paul wrote to Timothy? All scripture is breathed out by God, 2 Timothy 3:16. The Bible is a God-given record, not only of doctrinal teaching or commandments, not only of divine wisdom and prophecy, but it is also a divinely given record of factual historical events, and the events of creation being the start of all of history. The people in Star Trek were concerned about time travel, weren't they? If you got to warp speed in the Starship Enterprise, you could go beyond that. You could be able to go forward or sometimes back in time. Well, time as we understand it did not exist before the creation that's described in Genesis 1. But here we have the record in these opening verses of the creation of time, of space, and of matter. And then the details of how God goes about creating a universe and a world here on earth and doing it for his own glory. And those last words I've just said are really important in everything we think about creation. That when God created the universe, his first objective was to do something for his own glory. And only secondly then, flowing from that, the plans and the purposes he had for those like you and me who bear his divine image. So for example, we read in Psalm 19 verse 1, the psalmist David says, the heavens that God created in the beginning, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork because he made it. Or Psalm 8, he writes this, O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. And while I look at the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? So those things must undergird our thinking about creation, that it is God's handiwork, it is made for his glory, and this work of creation is recorded without error in the word that he has given us. However, all of us know that the biblical story of creation has in recent times come under severe criticism, and by some it is considered to be ridiculous. Up until the 19th century, that was very much less the case. But with the rise of evolutionary theory, popularized in the writings of Charles Darwin, the whole idea of a divine creator has been called into question, and people continue to do that today. And we addressed that a little bit last week. We posed this question, I think, at the start. Why would you think it foolish to believe in creation by the design and the purpose of an almighty creator God? Why would that seem foolish? And yet, you're perfectly prepared to believe that all of the complex world and universe we now live in supposedly evolved following an inexplicable Big Bang and through an incredible series of accidental events that stretch back over billions of years. The point that's always worth emphasizing is this, that evolutionary, the evolutionary idea is something that simply cannot be scientifically proven. It can only ever be accepted, in fact, by faith. It's never true to say that the Bible account of creation is a matter of faith, as some would say, but evolution is scientific fact. No, it certainly is not. However, one of the challenges thrown up in order for evolutionary theory to work is that it requires the present universe, this world we live in, to be the product of forces that were at work over many millions of years, in fact, several billion years. Current evolutionary estimations place the universe at around 13.8 billion years old, and the Earth as being about 4.5 billion years old. Those are incredibly long periods of time. And they seem, of course, to us clearly at odds with what we read in the Bible. Because the Bible provides us with genealogies of those who are descended from Adam, the first man. Genesis 5 has the genealogy of Adam's descendants. Then in Genesis 10, those descending from Noah after the flood. Then and later in Genesis and so on, you've got the descendants of Abraham, and that's also traced through the Gospels as well. You have lists of the kings of Israel and so on. And it would seem possible to make an attempt, therefore, reading the Bible at calculating the age of the earth. And that age, of course, would end up being in terms of thousands rather than billions of years. Back in the year 1650, Archbishop James Usher, who was then the Archbishop of Armagh, calculated the date of creation as being 4004 BC. Now, some biblical scholarship has since questioned whether there might not be some possible gaps in the genealogies that are recorded in the Bible, but even if you allowed for that, at very most, it would still leave the age of the earth and the universe at less than 10,000 years old, not billions of years. So what are we to believe in all of this? And what in particular are we to make of Genesis chapter 1 that speaks of the universe being created by God in the space of 6 days? Well, leaving aside what the unbelieving evolutionists think for a moment, this has also become, it has to be said, an area of some significant perplexity for believing Christians who have tried various means to reconcile the biblical account of creation with the very different claims of evolution. Before I mention some of those, I want to state my own position very clearly, if you don't already know it, and that is simply that I find no problem whatsoever in believing in a young earth and a young universe that was indeed created entirely by God in 6 24-hour days. That's what the Bible says, that's what I believe. But it is worth addressing for a moment some of the alternative ideas that some Christians have adopted in recent times. Now, there are other materials. I also want to say that you could go and read if you want more specific answers to the challenges raised by science, and I really would encourage you to read those. I know that there are issues in various areas. There's the whole issue of what do you do with the fossils and the fossil record and the years that it seems to represent. What do you do with the issues surrounding radiometric dating of both fossils and rocks and so on? You've got to face those issues. I don't want to dwell on those things in these Sunday morning messages, not least because it can all become quite complex and honestly quite difficult maybe for some folks to follow. But I do recommend, I always recommend this website that come up before you now on the screen. Answersingenesis.org is one. The Institute for Creation Research, ICR.org is another. There are many books on the whole area of creation science that do not see a conflict between creation and the idea of a young earth or a six-day creation. I know I have a couple of my I meant to bring them with me, I forgot. My bookshelves. One's called simply How Old is the Earth by a man called Monty White, Dr. Monty White. That's one example. There's lots of books out there. Nonetheless, how have some Christians sought to reconcile evolutionary theory with Genesis chapter 1? And by Christians, I mean people who believe the gospel and who have really wanted to believe in the truth of the Bible, because there are people who are under the broad umbrella of Christianity. We might call them liberals, and they have never believed the Bible really on anything. They just simply do not believe in the miraculous. They deny things like the resurrection of Jesus. They deny the miracles of Jesus. So the fact that they would deny the story of creation is not surprising. But there are others, people who have been sincere and evangelically minded Christians, who have said, I want to uphold my faith and I want to uphold the truth of the Bible. What do I do with evolution? And probably the most well-known and the first idea that this was first developed in the 19th century was something called the gap theory. And you might say, why do you need to tell me about this? I need to tell you about it because if you've got a Scofield Reference Bible at home, and some of you might have that, well, it's in that Bible. If you've listened to certain preachers, maybe in the past or the present, they will push this theory. And it became popular, in fact, amongst the whole fundamentalist movement at a time in America. And it suggests that between what we read in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, there is, in fact, a gap of some very, very considerable amount of time. And that, in fact, they will say there was a previous created world. That's what you read about in Genesis 1. God created the heavens and the earth. That's a previous world, a world that had plant and animal life, and that had also some kind of human life prior to Adam and Eve. However, the story goes with the gap theory, because of the rebellion and the fall of Lucifer, of Satan, a fallen angel, God decided to destroy that previous world in a cataclysmic way, possibly by a flood. Hence, therefore, you read in verse 2 of Genesis 1, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And they say at that point, God then began a second creation. This time it was the literal six-day creation you read in Genesis 1. And he made the whole thing over again. And the idea behind the gap theory is you put all the issues to do with the fossil record, all those claims about millions of years, you put them into this gap. And we don't know how long the gap was. We don't know very much about it. But you've solved the problem. But it doesn't solve the problem. In the first instance, it certainly doesn't satisfy the evolutionist. Evolutionist is still very unhappy with this idea of a newly created world made in 6 days. They still won't run with that. And from a Christian perspective, it's also problematic. If there's an almost unnoticeable but huge gap between Genesis 1 verse 1 and Genesis 1 verse 2, well, where else might there be a huge gap in the Bible that we know nothing about? Doesn't seem to be that way, but that's kind of implied. Furthermore, it raises a problem that will beset other attempts to make evolution fit with the Bible. And here's this issue. The issue is this, that in this world, if you follow the gap theory and other theories, you are believing that there was death in the world before the sin of Adam and Eve. And you only meet Adam and Eve in Genesis 2, and you only read about their sin in Genesis 3. And I didn't take time to read earlier from Romans chapter 5, but in Romans chapter 5, you're in a part of the Bible that explains in very great detail the biblical doctrine of sin. And here's what it says in Romans 5, verse 12. Here's what happened when sin came into the world. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all had sinned. The New Testament clearly connects the curse of death in the world with the entrance of human sin. The perfection of the Garden of Eden could potentially have been a place of unending life had it not been for Adam and Eve in each in turn eating from the forbidden fruit and sinning against God. And the Bible is consistently clear in the fact that death originates in human sin, the sin of that original couple, Adam and Eve. And that also poses a problem for other attempts to marry Genesis 1 with the theory of evolution. Another commonly held idea that Christians try to kind of use is the idea of what they say is a progressive creation, a process of evolution in which they say the days of Genesis 1, they call it the day-age theory, they'll say the days, the 6 days of creation, aren't actual literal days. They really are 6 very long ages and periods of time. This is why I remember being taught this in Bible class, would you believe, when I was a kid. That they represent 6 ages of time. And it wasn't my Bible class teacher that did it. It was somebody else standing in for the day. I have to put him in the right. He would never have said that. But this was said to me one occasion. 6 long ages of time. And therefore, those can be millions of years long, or billions of years if you wish, and you fit evolution into that. And you can also put a Christian spin upon it, because it's not the Darwin idea that evolution takes place just by accident and just by natural selection, the survival of the fittest and so on, and the species and so on. No, they say, This is God-designed evolution, sometimes called theistic evolution, where God had his hand in it, and God was making evolution happen. And they say that solves your problem. But it doesn't solve your problem. Again, that suggests that there was death before sin. If you have this idea that there was these primitive life forms that originally came into being and then they evolved into other life forms and into ever increasingly more advanced life forms, animal life, and ultimately evolving into human life, all along the way there's death, 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 death. The Bible does not allow for that to happen. Now, it again may satisfy the kind of troubled hearts of some Christians, but the idea of this idea of an old earth and millions of years, but again, it doesn't satisfy the demands of the secular evolutionist. He will look at that and he say, but even if you follow those 6 periods of time, they've got it all wrong. It's not what the evolutionary record tells me. Everything's all mixed up. It's not all in the right order. The evolutionist, the secular evolutionist, will not be happy with it. The other thing that simply needs to be said in reading Genesis 1 is that the Hebrew word yom, which is translated as day, is most commonly understood to mean a period of 24 hours. Occasionally, yes, it does in the Bible sometimes refer to a longer period of time, but the natural reading of the word in the context of Genesis 1 is that it means a day as we understand it. Although it has to be said again that some try to bypass all of that by suggesting to us that Genesis 1 is really just poetic language. It's just imagery. It's not history. But I take the view, and I teach the view, as most of historic Christianity has ever taught, that Genesis 1 is the factual history of God's creation of the universe, and in particular of this world that we live in. I don't know why you've got all of that. Ultimately, this. The biggest moral and theological problem raised by the idea of evolution actually concerns humanity. If men and women just slowly evolve from some other animal form, perhaps an ape or some kind of prehistoric human-like creature, then at what point can we say that men and women were made in the image of God? That key verse, Genesis 1:27, says this: "So God created man in his own image, in the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. That verse strongly implies that men and women are God's special creation, specifically designed to be his image bearers. And they have not just evolved from some lower life form. And it's by being God's image bearers that human beings therefore have a special dignity above other forms of life. And that human beings have a special purpose in God's plans, not least his plan of salvation, that they can know God in a personal way. And that human life also has a special sanctity. Now we'll come to those things again next time. But the one final thing I ask you to note for this morning is that in our understanding of the gospel, our understanding of creation is crucial, especially the creation of that original human couple, Adam and Eve. For Adam stands in Scripture as the representative head of the whole human race. And it is therefore Adam's sin that brings the curse of sin and death and God's judgment upon all of humanity and upon all who come after him. All of humanity are fallen in Adam. They are spiritually lost in their sin. But then the gospel. It is by the coming of the Son of God, Jesus, without sin, and taking our humanity, that he becomes the perfect sacrifice for sinners. And then Jesus Christ is referred to often as the second Adam, or the last Adam, he's called in 1 Corinthians 15:45, because Jesus bears the sins of humanity upon himself in his death on the cross. He bears our judgment, he dies our death, and by rising to life again, he conquers death. And he provides for lost humanity the salvation that they need. Jesus represents us in our sin when he dies on the cross. And that's how he provides a way for our sins to be pardoned. And in his rising to life, he brings those who are dead in sin the promise of a new life and of an eternal life. It's all spelled out in detail in that glorious fifth chapter of Romans. You could read that for yourself. And also it's spelled out here in 1 Corinthians 15, that great chapter about the resurrection. For as by a man came death, that's Adam, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead, that's Jesus. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ shall all be made alive. And that, my friends, is the only hope that we have for this life and especially for eternity. That we should place our hope and our trust in Jesus, who died for our sin, the sin we have inherited from Adam, and Jesus who rose again to give us new and eternal life. But without knowing Jesus, without trusting in what he has done for us, we remain in our sin and we remain under the judgment of God. This morning, I've spent trying to help you understand the Bible's teaching on creation. But the one who is our creator is the one who also sent his Son to be our Savior. In fact, the Savior was there at creation. He was part of it, making the universe. How tragic if we would believe all the right things about our Creator God, but miss the more wonderful fact that the Son of God, through whom the world was created, also came into this world to be our Savior. Don't miss that, or you'll die in your sin. And your soul will be lost forever. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are those today who are not simply destined to die. and die without hope. But we are those who can come to know Jesus today and in him find resurrection from the dead. In him find the one who cancels out the sin of Adam through his death on the cross, and the one who would give us a new life and a new hope. May that be the best thing we take from this message this morning. We have such a great Savior. Yes, the one who flung stars into space at creation, but the same hands were nailed to the cross for our sins. And we thank you for that in his name. Amen. Let's sing as we finish, how deep the Father's love for us. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us today and forevermore. Amen.